Good morning, everyone. So in this lecture, we will discuss about the different instruments that can be used for measurement of pressure. Pressure is one of the important physical quantities, and you can encounter pressure in many situations. For example, your wheels, whether they are the wheels of a car, motorbike, cycle, all have air filled with some pressure, and you have to keep a particular amount of pressure so that your bike, scooter, car, they can run smoothly. So you need to measure that pressure regularly. Similarly, in many other situations, measurement of pressure is very, very important. So pressure measurement, it can be divided into three categories: moderate pressure measurement, high pressure measurement, and low pressure measurement. So for moderate pressure measurement, essentially there are two types of devices which can be included in this category. One is manometers. Simple U-tube manometers or some modified version of manometers. So they can be used for measurement of moderate pressure. And secondly, we can use elastic elements. Now, manometers are meant for measuring static pressures, means when there are not much changes in pressure. While the elastic elements, they can be used for measuring static as well as dynamic pressure measurements. So you all must be familiar with manometers, and you must have studied manometers in your first year thermodynamics course, thermal sciences. So in this figure, a simple U-tube manometer is shown. So a U-tube manometer, it has two legs. So one is exposed to the pressure which we are going to measure, and another one is exposed to the atmosphere. So suppose P1 we want to measure and P2 is exposed to atmosphere, then suppose if P1 is high, then it pushes the manometric fluid downwards, and there is some difference between the two levels. Suppose this is equal to H, then this H can be related with pressure difference by this equation as equals to P1 minus P2 into rho G, where rho is the density of the manometric fluid and G is the acceleration due to gravity. So by measuring H, we can calculate P1 if we know P2, and usually P2 is the atmospheric pressure. So from this equation, P1 can be calculated. Now this manometric fluid, it has some desirable characteristics. So first one is it should be non-corrosive and do not have any chemical reaction with the fluid whose pressure is being measured. So sometimes we have to measure the pressure of fluid, so that fluid will be here up to this point, and at this point the means manometric fluid and the fluid whose pressure we are measuring, they meet at this point, so they should not have any chemical reaction, and this fluid should be non-corrosive, so it does not corrode the environment in which it is associated. Secondly, it should have a low viscosity so that it can easily move inside the tube, and thus it ensures quick adjustment with pressure changes. And third one, it should have negligible surface tension and capillarity effects. Now, in certain situation, we need a special type of manometers. So for that, you can have inclined tube manometer. So if the height difference is not large enough because of the small pressure difference, then sometimes it is not easy, means you cannot easily measure it because it is very small. So to detect the small change is very difficult. So in that case, you can use inclined tube manometer. In that case, we are having an inclined tube, and because of the inclination of the tube, this H2 is greater than H1, and that H2 can be easily detected. Similarly, for measuring the small change, one can use micrometer. So you can note the initial position of the fluid before the application of pressure and final position after the application of pressure, and the difference can be calculated from the micrometer reading, means how much it is moved. So depending upon the situation, there are a wide variety of manometers, and they all can be used for the moderate pressure. Then second elements which can be used for moderate pressure measurement is elastic transducers. Elastic elements, when subjected to pressure, get deformed. So when you apply pressure on elastic elements, they get deformed, and the deformation when measured gives an indication of the pressure. So by measuring the deformation, one can know the value of the applied pressure. Now these elements have different forms, like diaphragms, bellows, then corrugated diaphragms, bored end tube. You must have means already learn about this Bowden tube pressure gauge. So Bowden tube is also a flexible element. Then capsules, helical tubes, etc. And the deformation may be measured by mechanical or electrical means. For example, in Bowden tube gauge, here we connected gears and lever arrangement, and this deformation can be measured. Similarly, you can also use some electrical means like LVDD, linear variable differential transformer, for measurement of the displacement because of the pressure. Now, by using these elastic elements, different type of measuring devices can be developed, made. So one of such devices is LVDT type pressure transducer. So this figure shows LVDT type pressure transducer. So here we are having bellows, and in this bellow we can apply pressure P, and the application of this pressure results in the movement of these bellows. And now this bellows is connected with this core of LVDT, and this is the primary winding of LVDT, and these two are the secondary windings of LVDT. So when there is no pressure, no movement of core, and the voltage which is developed in secondary windings, they are equal, and the difference between these voltages are zero. When pressure is applied, it results in the movement of bellows, which in turn result in the movement of core, and the voltage generated in secondary windings will be different. So there is a net difference between V1 and V2, and by measuring that difference, we can measure this displacement, and in turn we can measure the applied pressure. So this is how this LVDT type pressure transducer works. Then we can have capacitive type pressure transducer. So this is the diaphragm. We apply some pressure, and because of the application of pressure, this gap reduces, and this reduction in gap in turn changes the capacitance of the capacitor, and we can attach this capacitor to the Wheatstone bridge. So change in capacitance will disturb the Wheatstone bridge, and we have to balance it. And how much voltage we need for balancing the Wheatstone bridge will in turn show, means by measuring these voltage we can know the how much the capacitance is changed, and by knowing the change in capacitance we can calculate the applied pressure. So this is how this capacitance type pressure transducer works. Then we can have piezoelectric type pressure transducer. So you all know that when some force is applied to a piezoelectric material, this is the piezoelectric material, and suppose one end or one surface of this piezoelectric material is connected to A, and this lower surface it is connected to B. So because of the deformation, when we apply some force, some electric voltages are generated. So by measuring those voltages we can measure the applied force or pressure. Similarly, we can have diaphragm type strain gauge pressure transducer. So we attached here some strain gauges in this diaphragm. So when the pressure is applied on this diaphragm, it will result in the strain on these strain gauges. And by measuring the strain, which you already learned in strain gauges. So if you can measure the strain, then you can measure the applied pressure. So these strain gauges, they are connected to the arms of the Wheatstone bridge, and with the help of Wheatstone bridge we can measure the strain in these strain gauges, and by measuring the strain we can calculate the pressure. Now comes to the high pressure measurement. So for pressures above 1000 atmospheric, so 1000 times higher pressure than atmospheric pressure, now we need special techniques for measuring such a high pressure. So one such technique is based on the electrical resistance change of a manganin, it is alloy of copper, nickel and magnesium. So, or gold chrome wire with hydrostatic pressure due to bulk compression effect. So this is one such device that can be used for the measurement of high pressure. So we are having this wire which can be made of this manganin or gold chrome, and here we are having high pressure. So when this high pressure is applied, so it will result in change in the resistance of this wire because of the bulk compression effect, and this change in turn will result in change in the means applied voltages or the current which is passing through this wire. So now this these two AB, they can be connected to some Wheatstone bridge. So suppose initially your Wheatstone bridge is balanced, and when you applied some high pressure, then it will result in the change in resistance, which further result in the change unbalance in the Wheatstone bridge. So we have to change the voltage so that our Wheatstone bridge will be again balanced. And that change in voltage will give you the value of change in resistance, and the change in resistance will give you the value of applied pressure. So in this way we can measure the now comes to the low pressure measurement, or you can also call it as vacuum measurement. So units of vacuum are torr or micron. One torr is a pressure equivalent of 1 millimeter of Hg, while 1 micron is 10 raised to the power minus 3 torr. So the manometer and elastic element, they can only be used up to 0.1 torr. And below these ranges, we need some other instruments for measuring the vacuum pressure. One such instrument is thermal conductivity gauge. So here we are having a metal. In this case, we are having a platinum filament. So this is exposed to this vacuum pressure, and this vacuum pressure which result in the change in thermal conductivity of this filament. And by measuring the change in thermal conductivity, we can calculate the pressure which is present in this tube, and thus we can measure the vacuum pressure. This slide shows another device that can be used for measuring low pressure or vacuum pressure. So this is MacLeod gauge, and this is used for measuring pressure which is in the range of 0.01 and 1000 microns. And it is also a modified form of a manometer. And it uses the principle of compressing a known volume of low pressure gas to a higher pressure gas and measuring the resulting volume change. And then by using the Boyle's law, one can calculate the pressure, initial pressure. So this is the MacLeod gauge. So what is done? So this is the cutoff point. So initially we allow the manometric fluid to move from this, move away from this. So by means lowering the screw, by means opening the screw, as this screw moves up, this manometric fluid will come down and it reaches to the cutoff point. So now when the manometric fluid reaches this point, this tube, it is connected to the source whose pressure we want to measure, and that gas comes through this into this bulb and capillary, and then we again and means lower this screw, and this will result in the coming of the manometric fluid again in this valve and also here, and we compress the manometric fluid such that it reaches again to this level which it was when it is originally filled. And the gas which is present here, whose pressure we are measuring, will be compressed into this much volume. And by measuring this Y, means this is the reference level, and this is the point up to which the gas is compressed. So by measuring this level, and we can calculate the pressure of the gas. So this is how this MacLeod gauge works. So this slide shows ionization gauge, another device that can be used for measurement of very low pressures of the order of 1 micron and below. Now this gauge consists of a triode vacuum tube. The heated cathode emits electron. So this is the heated cathode, and it emits electron. And here we are having a grid that is positively charged. So since electrons have negative charge, and this is the positively charged grid, so electron moves towards this. Now the electron moves towards the grid, they ionize the gas molecules through collision. So the gas whose pressure we have to measure, That gas is ionized. Now the plate is maintained at a negative potential so that the positive ions collect there, producing a plate current I1. So this is again at a negative potential, so and this is having a positive potential, so a current I1 is developed. Electrons and negative ions are collected by the grid, producing grid current I2. So another current I2 is generated here, and this is the relation which has been found, that pressure is equal to 1 by k I1 and I2, where I1 is the current developed in plate and I2 is the current developed in grid, and k is the sensitivity of the gauge. In this way one can measure the pressure of the gas. This slide shows another device that can be used for low pressure measurement, and that is Knudsen gauge. So in this type of gauge, the gas chamber consists fixed placed. So we are having two fixed plates, F1 here and F2 here, and they are heated and maintained at a temperature T. Near these plates is a restrained movable vane V. So this is the movable vane V, such that the gap between the vane and the fixed plate is less than the mean free path of the gas whose pressure is to be measured. So this distance is very, very small and is less than the mean free path of the gas molecules, and it is at the constant temperature T0. So these fixed plates F1 and F2, they are at the temperature T, and this movable vane is at the temperature T0, and this gap is very, very small, less than the mean free path of the gas molecules. The gas molecules rebound from plate F1 and F2 because molecules are always in random motion, so they rebound. From F1 and F2 with greater momentum than from V, thus imparting a net force to V. So a net force is imparted, and which result in the angular displacement of this mirror, which is fixed to the movable vane. And by measuring this angular displacement, one can measure the pressure, which is given by this equation. P is equal to Kf under root T minus T0 minus 1, where K is the sensitivity of the Knudsen gauge. So this is all about pressure measurement. Now we are having two more topics left. One is torque measurement and angular velocity measurement. So that we will discuss in the next lectures. Okay, thank you very much. Have a nice day.